Custom Logic is a feature that lets you quickly compose behaviors for assets or characters in the experimental version of Struct Studio. Even though it's still in development, it's already very powerful and can help you create games beyond the limits of Struct. In this video, we'll start with the basics and create a few simple behaviors. To bring up the Custom Logic graph, you can select any asset and click on the plus sign in the Custom Logic menu. This is where we'll start building our behavior graphs. Simple graphs are generally built like this: when a condition happens, then trigger an action. These are all called nodes, and the graph runs from the execute node in sequence all the way to the bottom. On the left, you'll see the node list that contains different node categories, but for now we'll focus on the action and condition nodes because we can already start building behaviors just with them. You can hover over nodes to see what each of them does, but let's start with a simple example to understand the workflow. Let's imagine we want our character to take damage when he gets close to the toxic fume. So let's add the custom logic and find the right nodes for this behavior. First, we need the condition, which is when the character is in proximity to the toxic fume. So let's click to add it. And the action we need is to deal damage to character. So we'll add this one as well. We'll place them under the execute node and we can connect them by click and dragging the arrows in between. So this graph now reads, when target is closer than distance to an object, then target takes damage. We'll talk about the specific toggles a bit later. These are called variables and we need to specify what they are. The target in this case is going to be our main character. So click on this link button and select new game object. You can see this pops up in the variables list here and we can rename it to main character. So when the main character is closer than, let's say, a distance of 3 to the object, which in our case is the toxic fume, so we'll create a new game object and call it toxic fume, then our main character takes, let's say, 5 damage. We'll also toggle the repeat to on because we want the graph to keep running so that the character continues to take damage when he's close to the fume. Finally, we can exit this menu and now we have to assign all the variables that we specified to our game objects from here. For the main character, we'll click assign and then click on the character, and then we'll also assign the toxic fume to the right object. Now we can playtest and see what happens. So we're taking damage as soon as we get close to the fume and it stops when we walk away. We can go back to the graph by clicking on this edit icon and we can change the distance or the damage depending on what we want and keep playtesting until we get it right. Now let's talk about the specific toggles next to these game objects. This is relevant when there are multiple instances of the same object in your game. So if we have multiple toxic fume assets but we only want a specific one to deal damage, then we'll toggle specific on for the toxic fume variable and then we have to make sure to assign it to the asset that we want to deal damage. So you can see these first two won't affect us, but we'll take damage when we get close to the third one. If we want all of them to deal damage, then we'll keep the specific toggle off. The same goes if we have multiple instances of the same character. If we only want one of them to be affected, then we have to toggle specific on and assign it to that character, otherwise they will all take damage when close to the fumes. Going back to the graph, you might have noticed that the variables list always includes a default self variable, which cannot be deleted or renamed. This variable is automatically assigned to the object we selected when adding the custom logic, which in our case was the toxic fume, but you can reassign it to another object if you want. So in our case, we didn't have to create a new variable for the toxic fume because we could have used the self variable instead, but in more complex graphs, it's easier to keep track of objects by creating new variables and naming them. To clean up the graph a little bit, you can right-click on the execute node and align all children, which aligns all the nodes below it. A final tip is that you can add nodes by clicking here in the list, but pressing space or right-clicking brings up a quick search menu where you can find all the nodes as well. And that's it. Those are the basics that will help us build so many more behaviors, and you can start exploring different combinations of conditions and actions. So let's say we want an NPC to say hi when we're close to them. The first step again is to add custom logic, and we'll start with the same proximity condition. Then we want to trigger the action that's going to show a text bubble above our villager, which is this one. We'll connect the nodes and we can start specifying the variables. So when the main character is closer than, let's say, a distance of 3 to the villager, then show speech bubble for villager with a text hi and a duration of 2. We'll assign the main character and the villager to the right assets and playtest. It would be nice for the NPC to look at us when they say hi, so we can actually do that with the look at node. Here we can specify villager looks at main character. Now, what if we want to say something back? Well, we can do that with the same text bubble node, and this time we'll say show speech bubble for main character with the text follow me. For a bit more realism, we can add a slight delay between the speech bubbles. For that, we can actually use the wait node, and we'll place it here in between and say wait for 1 second. Here's what we have so far. The dialogue looks a bit more natural now, but what if we do want the villager to actually follow us? We can do that with the change behavior node, and we'll change the villager's behavior to follow. Now, after they talk, the villager starts to follow our character. The only downside is that every time they get close to each other, the speech bubbles will keep popping up because the graph is set to repeat, so it'll keep running over and over. But we want the graph to run only once after the condition is met, so instead we can use the repeat until success node. We'll place it before the condition, connect it, and then we can switch off the repeat. Now the villager follows the character, but the speech bubbles won't show up every time they get close to each other, which is what we want. So as you can see, going step by step and playtesting is the easiest way to start building up behaviors. In the next video, we'll explore more complex behaviors, but in the meantime, see if you can figure out the graph that's needed to open a gate when stepping on a platform. Have fun, and let us know what you'd like to learn next.